Hello, good morning everyone. Thank you for joining this webinar today. I appreciate you're all very busy and finding the time to attend these webinars can be challenging. So thank you very much for joining us. Today, I'm joined by my colleagues, so Diana Perrier from our Marcom team, who will be organizing and looking after the logistics of this webinar. If you have any issues, please let Diana know through the text chat box that I'll talk about in the next slide. I'm also joined by my colleague, Benjamin Wyatt, who is one of our application support scientists that's responsible for actually helping to develop this method that I'll talk about today, but also for making sure that when someone purchases one of our systems to install this methodology on the system, Benjamin is one of the people who will come to make sure that it successfully works in your laboratories. So Benjamin's actually going to take care of questions and answers that you may have during the webinar, and we have a facility to do that on our ON24 software that we use for these webinars. So hopefully you can see the Q&A text box. I know some of you have used it already, which is great that you were able to find that easily and use the tool. It's there to allow you to ask questions through the webinar, and Benjamin's very happy to answer those. Hopefully we'll have time at the end. I will slowly go through this slide to make sure with my Scottish accent that I'm understandable, but also I want to make sure that I cover everything correctly as well. But again, as I mentioned, hopefully I'll leave time at the end to answer a few of the questions live as well. Okay, so this is the fifth webinar we've done over the previous years now on anionic polar pesticides. I won't cover any of the background information from those previous webinars. I know many people have joined us who have actually come to those previous webinars. All of the material can be found on our website, and I will give you the link to the appropriate pages on our website for at the end of the webinar. However, of course, if you have any questions on the background or the method that's been developed, you can again ask them through the webinar, and Benjamin's happy to answer. Or again, we can contact you offline after the webinar to discuss it in more detail. For the contents today, I will discuss the Taurus DEA, which is a diethylamine column that regards to the chromatography of these anionic polar pesticides. And then we'll discuss some of the LC-MS/MS method performance on matrices, such as flower and tomatoes. Then I'm going to let you see some of our rapid LC-MS/MS method work on oxyanions or chlorine and perchlorate. This is some of our most recent work that's actually just been carried out in the last few weeks. We continue to do a lot of work in our laboratories on polar pesticides, constantly looking at different matrices. Last week myself, with a little bit of a Christmas theme to it, I was looking at cranberries. They were actually quite challenging because of their high pigmentation. Almost solved that problem. A little bit more work to do, however. Again, you can see we're constantly still working on these in the laboratory. My colleague, Dr. Stuart Adams, who joined us around about 4 months ago, is actually working on the direct analysis of polar pesticides in drinking water and surface waters. So again, it's something that's constantly ongoing in our laboratory. And again, we provide everybody updates on a sort of regular basis through webinars such as these. Okay, so moving on. So I'm not going to go too in-depth into the challenges of these compounds today. The challenges are quite well known, and really they can be summed up into these four aspects. So of course, we need retention. They're highly polar. They don't work by traditional C18 approaches. Even our more C18s designed for polar retention, such as our high-strength silica T3 type ligands, can't retain these compounds, even in high aqueous mobile phases. So they're very highly polar, not suitable to reverse phase without derivatization, the FMOC reaction, to make them more hydrophobic and bigger molecules. So alternative modes of retention are required. These can be mixed modes, they can be ion chromatography, or in the case of what we'll discuss today, they can be helic plus weak anion exchange chromatography. Once we have retention, there are some crucial separations that are required. So we want to be able to separate the compounds away from each other anyway by LC-MS/MS to allow us to avoid the compounds suppressing each other. But there are some compounds that will degrade to their metabolites and source, And there's other that will interfere because they share common ions, which I'll discuss through this webinar. I hope, or I'm sure many people are familiar with the highly aqueous extraction methods used for these compounds. The one that we use the most in a European laboratory is the QIPE method, so the quick polar pesticide extraction. In terms of extracting the compounds out, it works well, but of course it also extracts out many matrix components as well, and things such as sugars, organic acids, which are particularly challenging for this analysis, amino acids, we have to be careful with things like proteins, we extract out some fats and lipids as well. So these can all cause challenges with the actual method itself. We also see what looks like parts of cellulose from plant cell walls and stuff as well that can be chromatographed during the analysis based on some of the high resolution work that we've been doing. So again, lots of things can get in there and interfere with our compounds. And then we have our detection itself, and we see very challenging detection limits required for this analysis. Although the MRLs for several of the compounds, when we look at the sort of pesticide commodity combinations, are actually very high, in many cases, what we understand from the laboratories, particularly because of the need to analyze infant food or organic food, is there's really a drive to low nanogram per mil or part per billion levels. So often we aim to reach the 10 micrograms per kilogram LOQ level for all pesticide commodity combinations where possible. Okay, so I'm going to start with the separation. So people who are aware of the Torus DEA column may have used this method on the left-hand side. So the original method that we developed was optimized to cover as many highly polar anionic compounds as we could, because this is what we were initially tasked to do based on the customer feedback we were having. So there was a drive and a desire to have the likes of glyphosate, its metabolites, the N-acetyl glyphosate version, N-acetyl glufosinate, glufosinate, MPPA, epiphone, phosphatidyl alumina, phosphonic acid, plus chlorate and perchlorate, all in a single method. This was achievable on the Torus DEA column. And again, for both methods, we actually have a common theme. So we use the same Torus DEA column. It's the same dimensions and particle size as well. We use the same acuity UPLC system, so we can actually benefit from the high resolution, the faster cycle times, and also the sharper, narrower, better peak shapes that we typically achieve with UPLC type chromatography. Column temperature, sample temperature, injection volume and flow rate all remain the same between both methods. The only difference between the two methods is the inclusion or exclusion of the buffer. So the Torus DEA is a helic-based column, but it has, as I mentioned, the diethylamine functionalized bonding. So that group itself has some ion exchange capacity, so it's a weak ion exchanger. So the inclusion of the buffer actually reduces some of the electrostatic interactions that can occur on the column. So what we typically see with that is it allows us to elute chlorate and perchlorate, and it also lowers the amount of solvent required, or the amount of aqueous, I should say, required to cause elution of our molecules. So if you look at the gradient itself, it's a little bit shorter than the one on the right, and you can see we only got 60% of the aqueous. And this is because of the inclusion of the buffer. The drawback, though, with a buffer is that it will suppress signal of several compounds in negative ion modes. That's a well-known phenomenon. We found ourselves through experiments that it really doesn't matter how much you have in there, you get suppression if it's in there. So that is the only drawback to the method. To reach the LOQ desired levels of 10 micrograms per kilogram, it's perfectly fit for purpose. And we have demonstrated that in our lab, but also external customer labs as well. However, because of the drive to have ultimate sensitivity, so there's always a desire in the food world, food analysis world, to have as much sensitivity as possible. But particularly for this assay, to take into account the desire to do a little bit more dilution with the sample cleanup to make the samples a bit more compatible with the injection, or due to the amount, for example, for wheat flour, where you take a lot less sample and do a lot more dilution, there's a desire to have even more sensitivity. This is what we spent some time doing. We already knew how to do it because we knew what lost our sensitivity in the first place. we just needed to adapt our gradient to account for it, and we had to accept that we were not going to be able to include chlorate and perchlorate into the what we did call the optimized sensitivity method. And again, this is because the interactions with the column are too strong now for chlorate and perchlorate, so it's very difficult to elute perchlorate. Chlorate itself has a very broad peak, which impacts on sensitivity. So we've developed a much faster separate method for chlorate and perchlorate that would allow you to very rapidly analyze those compounds. That's the difference between the two methods. So we have one that allows you to include a very vast suite of the compounds with chlorate and perchlorate added, which uses the buffer. If you're happy to sacrifice chlorate and perchlorate to gain significant gains in sensitivity, then we have the method on the right, which we only now use 0.9% formic acid and LCMS water to induce elution. And you can see to allow that, we have to go slightly higher with the gradient. However, because of the type of column this is, with the polar functionalized ligands, we can accommodate this higher amount of aqueous into the gradient itself with no issues. So this is just some examples of the separations. I haven't included all the compounds in the chromatogram, the reason being that you wouldn't see all the peaks if I did that. But I wanted to give you a highlight of the type of chromatography you see for all of the key compounds. You can see the list as we go down, I won't call them all out, but you can see importantly, perchlorate and chlorate are added in this method. One thing that I couldn't include, but it does elute perfectly fine with good peat shape, is phosphatidyl alumina. And one difference you see between the two methods is you have a selectivity shift between phosphatidyl alumina and phosphonic acid. So phosphatidyl alumina in the method containing the buffer will actually elute before phosphonic acid. In method B, we would remove the buffer, phosphatidyl alumina actually elutes after phosphonic acid. This is the chromatography we were seeing in the past. This is the chromatography with method B, which is the method optimized for sensitivity. So you can see the compounds tested and that work well in this column with this method all remain apart from chlorate and perchlorate, which, as I mentioned, we've developed a new rapid method for, which I'll highlight at the end of this webinar. However, you can see peak shapes are all really good. You can see the selectivity shift now between phosphonic acid and phosphatidyl alumina. And actually, if you excuse me for going back a slide, you can see the retention of the compound is actually a lot longer on the second method than it is the first. And again, that's because by removing the buffer, we reduce, we actually have a little bit more electrostatic interaction going on. So we get some more retention going on in the column as well. So of course, as I go along, I will point out key aspects of the SANTI guidelines, which are the guidelines that we develop our methods to in-house so that they can show a fit for purpose nature for your analysis as well. So of course, one of the key aspects of the guidelines is to have more than two times a column void of retention. So what I've indicated here is the T0. So the T0 from a chromatographic term is what we call the dead volume. And the dead volume takes into account the column void volume, but also the flow rate that you're running at. As we're running at half a mil a minute, and the void volume of this column is 0.24 minutes, we're actually two times the void volume, or the T0, which is the dead volume, at 0.48 minutes. So this would be equivalent to two times the void volume. So you can see the retention of our first eluting compound in method B, which is our method without buffer, the optimized sensitivity method, and for our elutes first, at 1.69 minutes, you can see we're more than 3.5 times our T0, so we get more than sufficient retention for this compound on this this method and column. And the same is for method A as well. We actually see ampere elute just a little bit later for the buffered method. So again, still having over 3.5 times our retention. So in terms of meeting the requirements of retention, this column is more than fit for purpose. Another aspect is retention time stability. Of course, we don't want our peaks moving all about the place. We want to have windows where we can so that we can maximize our sensitivity for this assay. So having a method where our peaks are shifting by significant times is not fit for purpose. Of course, if we have labeled isotopes, we can still confirm our peaks, but of course, it makes it very difficult for quantification purposes, particularly if we have issues with matrix peaks also showing up in our analysis as well. So retention time stability, within the plus or minus 0.1 minute limit of the SANTI guidelines is of course important. And again, this column shows that capability. So here you can see we're looking at roughly 40 injections. We ran a batch of tomato and wheat flour. So each had 37 injections. So times that by two was the total batch size. And you can actually see that we get relatively no retention time shift during the run. In a single matrix or between the two matrices, they're both actually very close. Both have been extracted using the Quippy extraction with no additional sample cleanup, apart from a freeze step for wheat flour that I'll discuss. However, you can see the in terms of retention time stability, the column actually works very well. As I mentioned, there's some really key separations that are indicated in the Quippy document itself, but I can also show you those from an actual mass spectrometry perspective as well by just opening up the windows and recording the MRM data for the whole analysis. So again, this is method B. So you can see phosphatyl alumina elutes after phosphonic acid, but you can see we separate those two compounds very well. So we actually separate them by baseline, which is excellent. And this is very important. And you can see phosphatyl alumina separates very far from AMPA, which is again something that's key, because as you can see, phosphatyl alumina, when it elutes, you can actually see not crosstalk, it's isobaric interferences in each of the MRM transitions for phosphonic acid and AMPA. So the reason this occurs is phosphatyl and AMPA both share the same MRM transition, which is the 110 to 81 transition. So of course, this is key to allow separation. Phosphatyl also degrades and source the phosphonic acid as well. So again, to avoid any false identifications, it's very important that these separations are maintained and that they're able to be resolved fully. This is also important for N-acetyl AMPA and AMPA as well. And as we see more the likely inclusion of the N-acetyl compounds into the regulations, of course, this is going to be even more important. So we already know that the N-acetyl glufosinate, or NAG, as some people call it, is already included into the residue definition of glufosinate. Of course, if you're looking at GMO-type products, you may already be looking for the N-acetyl versions of glyphosate and AMPA already as well. But of course, again, there's a lot of interest in being able to analyze these due to potential inclusion into regulations in the future. So of course, another aspect of in-source degradation can be N-acetyl AMPA, can of course create AMPA in source, which can cause an interference. So again, you can see as I highlight below, looking at the N-acetyl AMPA, which is very well separated from AMPA. You can still see though, when we open up the windows and allow the windows to be fully open to capture all the data, you can see N-acetyl AMPA actually showing up as AMPA in the AMPA trace. So again, if you didn't have this separation, there would be a risk of false identification. So before I start going through some of the method, LCMS method data in more detail, I just wanted to take a moment to talk about the extraction that we've used for the tomato and wheat flour examples that we show today. We've been testing many matrices, as I mentioned. So last week myself, I was looking at carrots and cranberries. And so we've applied this method to a very diverse range of matrices, from olives to tea to different cereals. Soya is one that we've looked at as well. I must say, soya bean is probably the hardest one we've ever looked at, but I'm sure there's other very difficult ones as well. Wheat flour itself isn't particularly easy because of the issues around filtration and stuff. However, we have been able to overcome them in our laboratory, as many people have. And I'll just talk you through some of the things that we've been trying to give you a bit of an update on where we're at. So the tomato itself, of course, is a very high water content commodity. A lot of organic acids in there. So again, that's something I'm going to show you in the next few slides, because organic acids can interfere with the analysis. And it's quite commonly known that citric acid and malic acid, can be compounds that interfere with the likes of AMPA or glyphosate. So it's very important if we can to try to separate those away from our analytes. However, not overly diverse from what I'm talking about in this slide. We take 10 grams of the tomato commodity, which has been homogenized. And then we adjust for the water content. We haven't used labeled internal standards for our work because we want to test the method without initially. Of course, the inclusion of internal standards will just better improve the linearity, the repeatability, and particularly the trueness in terms of recovery. However, because we want to give the method a sort of true test, at the moment we haven't been including labeled standards. And already we're very satisfied with the linearity and repeatability that we get. So we only suspect that including the internal standards will make it even better. So after adjusting the water content, because we don't add the labeled IF, we then extract with the 10 mils of methanol containing the 1% formic acid, or the Crippy solvent, as it's commonly known. Vortex for 1 minute, and then we centrifuge at 5,000 RPM for 5 minutes. And then we filter through a 0.45 micron PVDF filter. So just out of habit, because we do it for the chlorate analysis, we typically also filter the solvent standard as well, the solvent blank as well, just to make sure that there's nothing coming off the filter. That's particularly important for the chlorate analysis, of course, because some filters, as highlighted in the Quippy, can actually leach chlorate into the analysis itself, so contaminating our samples. The flour is slightly different. Of course, we take a lot less, so we're actually taking 5 grams of flour in this case. We used organic flour to try and reduce any risk of any incurred residues. Our one was actually quite good. It contained no incurred residues for what we're looking at, only a very small amount of glyphosate, but not significant enough to affect our analysis. So we do a slightly different extraction here. So we take 5 grams of our commodity, and we add 10 mils of LC-MS water. We have been experimenting with replacing the LC-MS water with a millimolar concentration of EDTA instead. We continue that, and we need to look at the recoveries we get. However, we have found that it does help with the analysis. The FBA extraction that's used in the US actually uses a highly aqueous extraction with sodium EDTA. This is to account for any collision that might occur between glyphosate and any metal species in the sample itself. And again, we see a potential benefit of that with this method. So we're going to do more work there. And of course, we'll report any benefits of that into an application note. So for the moment, we only use LC-MS water. We then vortex. We add the Quippy solvent, or the methanol containing 1% formic acid, and then we vortex. But before we centrifuge the wheat flour, we actually place it into a freezer for 2 hours. And the reason why we do that is anybody who's tried to analyze wheat flour or another cereal will know that if you take your commodity, you vortex it and then centrifuge it and then try to filter it, you're just going to end up with acidic wheat flour and methanol and water all over your face because the filter just pops because there's still too much viscosity, but also too many non-diluted material in the sample, non-dissolved species in the sample. So it allows us to get more of the polysaccharides, starches, and the other commodities of the other matrix components of the commodity to be centrifuged out. Adding in this freeze step, of course, allows us to do so. And again, that is indicated in the Quippy document, and I know other people are also using that today. So we have that freeze step. It does make the centrifugation step more effective, and it does make the possibility to filter the samples much more effective as well. You only have to do flour once and get it all over your face to know the impact this free step really has on your analysis. In saying that, the matrix themselves remain complex because we don't add a cleanup step, and it's very difficult to add a selective cleanup step into this analysis. We have been exploring cation exchangers, and we have done some work there with a collaborator in Turkey, the National Reference Lab. We've also been doing some work. I've done some myself last week. I used MCX to remove the pigmentation from the cranberry. It was very effective. However, I lost glufosinate to that extraction as well. And I'll discuss that a little bit as we go through. But again, it's very difficult to have a cleanup step for all of the analytes. You can have very selective cleanup steps for one or two of them at a time, but to have a selective cleanup step that covers them all is quite difficult at the moment. Of course, many of the compounds, such as organic acids, wouldn't be removed by something like MCX. So we would only reduce some of the complexity. And just looking at complexity, this is a radar scan. All of our Xevo tandem quadrupole systems are capable of running a full scan whilst running MRMs because of the way that we run the full scans by scanning on the quadrupole. So it allows us to keep the collision gas on in the collision cell. So we're able to very quickly switch between MRM and full scan. I find this myself an extremely useful method development tool. It allows me to see if there are any matrix components that are eluting at the same time as my analytes of interest. But it also allows me to look at the chromatography. Am I separating my compounds away? And also whether or not the cleanup steps that I may have added in has been effective or not. This is wheat flour. This is effectively a full scan that's been run from 50 to 500 AMU. Typically, we run within that range or up to 1,000. But of course, really, we're trying to run over the range of the compounds in a similar mass range to our analytes. You can see for wheat flour, it's very complex. It's not surprising. There's many things going on in there. We could use high resolution to try and identify these a bit more. We have gone in to look for things like the organic acids, and of course, they're there and present. It's not surprising that they're there. There are other components as well, of course, in there. So I just want to show you an example of where I've used our radar tool and for method development. So this is the tomato sample. This is the blank matrix itself that's been extracted by the Quippy extraction. So one of our concerns with tomato is, of course, it's very high in organic acids. Malic acid and citric acid are the two most abundant in tomato. So I've actually taken the radar scan. So you can see here, again, even for tomato, it's a very complex matrix. This is our full scan. And what I've done is I've looked over the first 2 minutes where we get elution of compounds such as AMPA, which tend to be the compounds that are most heavily suppressed during analysis of all the columns we've tried. So it's always interesting for us to see what matrix components might be eluting at the same time. So I've gone in and I've basically looked for the peaks around about the same retention time as AMPA. The one that stood out was this peak here, which I've highlighted. Unfortunately, I really apologize, the times on the chromatogram haven't showed up as well on this one, but it's roughly around the 1 minute 80, sorry, 1.8 minutes time frame. So I've actually filled out the spectrum, and what you can actually see is I have the 133 ion, and then I have a 115 and a 97. So this would be a loss of water and then a loss of two waters. So 133 would be the negative ion, precursor ion for malic acid, which has a molecular weight of 134. So that makes sense. And then looking through literature, also looking at the structure itself, the 115 fragment, which we can see, I can pull it out as a peak, is also a likely suggestion that what we're looking at with this peak is malic acid. So this is all done through nominal mass using our radar scan. Of course, I have some insight into what I'm looking for. So I can see this and I can work out that I've got a loss of water, a loss of two waters. This is matching what I would expect from malic acid. However, I've gone on to then confirm it. So we actually ordered a malic acid standard and we actually diluted that into the diluted Quippy solvent. So effectively we've taken our 1% methanol and we've diluted it 1:1 with water as our matrix would be. And what we can see is if we look at the second chromatogram from the bottom, this is our suspected malic acid peak in the tomato matrix. So now I'm running the MRMs. So the MRMs I've used are as before. So we have the 133 to 115 and the 133 to 97. And I've actually then ran the malic acid standard, which is a pure malic acid standard in solvent. And you can see the retention times are very much matching up. But also importantly, the ion ratios match as well. So this suspected malic acid has been confirmed by ion ratio and retention time as well. So we can see the malic acid, it is there. It's there at very high levels. So we're looking at extremely high levels in the sample, but very nice peak shape, but also well separated away from AMPA and glufosinate as well. So malic acid itself should not cause any issues with suppression for these two compounds, which is good. So we already know that that's not causing us an issue as well. We also looked at citric acid, and it doesn't appear to correlate with any of the compounds either. So again, the two major organic acids that we typically know can cause issues, the compounds such as AMPA, glyphosate, and glyphosate, are not causing issues on the column using the method B. Again, I've already highlighted that MCX is one potential solution to cleaning up the samples. Again, it can't remove things, of course, like organic acids or other ionic species, but it can remove cationic species and more hydrophobic lipid-type compounds as well. But it's also useful for some pigmentation as well, particularly if it's hydrophobic or it has a cationic charge on there too. So tea is one example that we did with our collaborators in the National Reference Lab in Turkey. You can see when we just do the quippy extraction, it looks as you would expect, like black tea. Not particularly injectable on the system. You could inject it if you wish, but of course your maintenance, routine maintenance would have to go up to continually clean the source. So we actually passed the sample through a 6cc 500 meg Oasis MCX device. In this case, we're able to remove quite a large amount of the pigmentation, and we also get our peaks back with acceptable recoveries in this case. I have tried a similar method with the cranberry cleanup that I will write up and put onto LinkedIn actually this week. One thing I've seen with that, unfortunately, that we didn't see with tea is that we actually lose glyphosate to the MCX device. So we know it's not matrix suppression, because when I spike into the blank matrix to create the matrix match curve, we get a very intense peak for glyphosate. So we know it's a recovery loss. The recovery loss is likely due to the fact, of course, that the quippy extraction itself contains formic acids. So of course, glyphosate and glyphosate both contain that amine group. So likely that group's being charged, of course, and it's retaining to the MCX device itself. So one potential solution to avoid this is to just not acidify. So we're going to explore that ourselves to see if we can improve our cleanup. But certainly from a pigmentation removal for the cranberry, which I suspect are something like anthocyanin, we actually get full removal of the pigments, which is very nice. Because when I tried it through a standard C18, I couldn't remove any of the pigments, they just broke through, and also on an Oasis HLB. So it seems that the MCX addition has helped us with that cleanup. Because of course, again, the cranberry extract just looked like cranberry juice. And although if you wished you could inject it, perhaps it would not be such a good idea from a maintenance perspective. Okay, so I'm going to talk about some of the sensitivity aspects now. So one thing that we are aware of, because we get a lot of feedback from customers who are using our older systems, but also competitor systems as well, is the Ethifon can suffer from in-source degradation, but also from degradation through the ion optics itself. So one of the improvements that I've gone into our Zeevo TQXS system, which is our high-end or our ultimate sensitivity tandem quad, is the ability to run what we call soft ionization mode. And this really is quite beneficial for compounds that can suffer from degradation through the ion optics or in the source, because we're able to avoid that significant degradation to get more intensity. So what you see at the bottom is we're just monitoring one of the key transitions for Ethifon. And you can see the peak that we get is actually perfectly acceptable and we'd meet the LOQs. However, if we run our soft ionization mode, which we can run along with our normal MRMs, no issues at all in terms of cycle time, we actually gain more than 2 times intensity, but we also gain in area temps as well. So again, it's a way of being able to use this system to really gain extremely high sensitivity for this analysis. And avoid the need for higher injection volumes as well, which of course can make the mass spectrometer dirtier quicker. So I want to talk about the observations that we have in terms of the improvements of method B in terms of sensitivity over method A. So we always debate how we show sensitivity, because everybody looks at sensitivity in different ways. We can talk to one person and ask them what sensitivity means to them, and they may talk about area counts, and then another person might talk about response, and then another person might talk about signal to noise, and then maybe they're really talking about all three. And of course, we need to be able to see the peak, because if we can't see the peak, then that's no use. However, we want to be able to see a consistent peak, and we also want to be able to see a peak that's well away from our noise and doesn't need to be overly smooth to be able to be seen. So I've kind of gone with a very complex graph, which hopefully, if I talk through, will make sense to everybody. So what we have on the left is basically the increase in peak area between the two methods. So basically, this is the improvement that we get in terms of peak area using method B, so the method without buffer, over the method with buffer. This is all in organic tomato, so it's all in a quippy extract, which has been spiked at the 10 micrograms per kilogram level. So what most people look for is an LO2. We are aware that many people would like to go lower than that, and that's why we've designed this new chromatography method, and where we run our Zeevo TQXS system to get the ultimate in the sensitivity we can. However, most people are comfortable with this as an LO2, which is why we chose to look at this level to show the improvements. So we look at the peak area, you can see in the pink we have phosphonic acid, which shows us a dramatic improvement up to 16 times. And then we have, for example, MPPA, which only shows around 2 times. So again, it's very compound dependent, but they all show an improvement. And if we look on average, we're looking between somewhere between 5 to 8 times improvement in area counts. Response, again, we can see, for example, glyphosate shows a very dramatic increase in response, and so does AMPA. The other compounds are also showing somewhere in the region between 2 to 5 times increase in response. So we've already seen that we get significant increases in peak area, significant increases in peak height by removing the buffer. Again, this is not unexpected. And again, from a thickness of noise perspective, we also see improvements, which of course is key because this is, again, a good indication of how low we can actually go from an LOQ and LOD perspective. So we can see again for phosphonic acid, for glufosinate, for MPPA, and for fossil alumina, we're seeing quite significant increases or improvements in the peak-to-peak signal to noise. So we always measure peak-to-peak at half height as well. What does that mean, though, from a chromatographic perspective? So what you can see here is AMPA using method B, which is the most intense peak, and then AMPA using the buffered method, method A. Effectively, method A has been normalized against the method B trace. Okay, so you can already see from a chromatic acid standpoint what that means. You can see AMPA itself has very good peak shape for both, more than acceptable, very little tailing. We have a startup procedure that we offer for this column. So we have a startup guide that talks you through how to get this method of setup and stuff. We provide assistance remotely or directly as well. So we're more than happy to do so to help you. However, what you can see here is the improvements and the signal between AMPA and method B and method A. We can also see here the glufosinate peak, which is also showing that improvement. So we can see here method B glufosinate is a significant increase in response versus glufosinate from method A. And again, we see the same for glyphosate as well. So as expected, and what we showed in the previous graph is we see a significant improvement in response between the two methods. Okay, so again, just to highlight the sort of detection that we need, if we look at the two matrices and we look at the MRLs from the European Union MRL database, you can see glyphosate and tomato and glufosinate have the lowest MRLs of the compounds we're looking at, which is 0.1 mix per kilogram. If we look at wheat flour itself, again, all of the MRLs are quite high, with the exception of glufosinate and some of its other compounds such as MPPA and N-acetyl and glufosinate. So it's related compounds, and these are expressed as glufosinate but taken into account in the residue definition. So we just look at the sensitivity we can achieve on the Zeevo TQXS using this method. This is example chromatography at 1 nanogram per mil in bile concentration in the tomato matrix. So that's the equivalent of 2 micrograms per kilogram. You can see Etifon has 2 transitions, AMPA is 2 transitions, glyphosate and phosphatidyl alumina both showing 2 transitions able to achieve these very low limits. If we look at wheat flour for glufosinate, for the compounds glufosinate, MPPA, and acetyl glufosinate, with the compounds with the lowest MRL, again, what we're looking at here is 1 nanogram per mil in vial in the matrix. This is equivalent to 4 micrograms per kilogram, taking into account the dilutions that would be used for wheat flour. And you can see, we can see two transitions for each compound with perfectly clear peaks as well. So the methods fit for purpose for the lowest compounds in these matrices. If we look at the calibration, you can see looking at the compounds using method B, we're able to achieve very low levels over and also over a very long range. So again, you can see for all the compounds in tomato, we can go from 2 micrograms per kilogram up to 200 micrograms per kilogram that we've tested, all very linear, and with back calculated residuals all acceptable within the 20%. For wheat flour, taking into account the dilution, we can see from 4 micrograms per kilogram up to 400. And again, all acceptable linearity and all acceptable back calculated residuals. We can see lower, so this isn't our LOD. However, these are the calibration ranges that we've tested, which allowed us to have calibration ranges which would be required for the laboratory that we've installed this method in today, but also fit for purpose with regards to the residue definitions. And in terms of repeatability, we've actually ran the matrix spike standards at the 5 nanograms per mil in vial, which is your 10 micrograms per kilogram, and also at 40 micrograms per kilogram, ran them N equals 15 between our two calibration curves. And you can see in terms of accuracy and precision, they're all very good. Repeatability at both levels, at the 10 micrograms and the 40 micrograms per kilogram, are all below 10% for all compounds in both matrices. And again, that's run 15 replicate injections. Okay, so just to summarize this part of the webinar, we looked at retention and we could see that the Taurus DEA column was more than capable of achieving over 2 times a column void volume. From a separation standpoint, we were also able to separate all of our key compounds. We also highlighted some of the concerns around matrix complexity, and we looked at some of the separations we can achieve between our analytes and organic acids. And we've also shown from a detectability standpoint, we can achieve very low levels. So for the second part of the webinar, I'm now going to concentrate on the oxyanions and the new rapid method we've developed for chlorate and perchlorate. So the method actually remains very similar to the very first buffered method that we created. However, we used the 5 centimeter column instead of the 10. So already we half our potential runtime. However, the gradient's also been optimized and we can actually reduce the runtime to 5 minutes. So we can have an extremely rapid method for this, still maintaining more than acceptable retention. So of course the void volume will have been reduced by half. So on the 10 centimeter, it was 0.24 minutes. Now it'll be 0.12 minutes on the 5 centimeter column. We use the buffer because, again, we want to weaken those electrostatic interactions with the two anions. But outside of that, we haven't changed too much of the method. The flow rate, the column temperature all remains the same. However, we can reduce the injection volume for these analytes as well, which from a cleanliness of the mass spec perspective is, of course, very useful. So you can see, as I mentioned already, based on the void of the column again and taking into account our T-naught, we actually can retain perchlorate more than 5.5 times greater than our T-naught, so more than sufficient retention for these analytes on our column. Retention time stability, so we're looking at 50 injections of chlorate. This is in milk and Brussels sprouts because I was having a little bit of a Christmas theme in the lab recently. So you can actually see these are the two runs, and you can see that the retention time of chlorate in the two matrices stays well within the 0.1 plus or minus 0.1 limit. And you can see actually between the two matrices, there is very little retention variation at all. So again, very stable method. I actually use Unispray, which people may or may not be familiar with, which is our slightly alternative ionization mode to traditional electrospray. I don't have a lot of time to really talk through it in detail. However, it's similar to electrospray in terms of the spectrum that you generate. However, we ionize the compound slightly different and we're able to direct more ionized species towards the sample cone, so we get greater intensities. So we're able to use our mid-tier system, which is our Zebo TQS micro, to achieve very low limits for these compounds in matrix. This is the MS method. We're using a capillary voltage at 0.5 kilovolts. And again, you can see the MRMs. So we have two MRM transitions for both chlorate and perchlorate. And this is just an example chromatogram at 1 ng/mL in solvent for perchlorate, just highlighting that the method's very sensitive for that particular compound. So again, what you can see here is a picture of our Unispray source. So Unispray differs from Electrospray in the sense that we don't have a capillary that we apply a voltage to for Unispray. So we actually pass a sample through, and the actual dissolvated ions hit a pin where we apply the energy. This causes the ions to tumble while they're charged, and then we have more of those charge ions entering into the mass spectrometer. So we can gain quite dramatically sometimes in signal improvement. In the case of chlorate, looking at the normalized response, so Unispray is at the top, Electrospray at the bottom, you can already see we get a much larger peak between the two. For chlorate, and again, you can see in terms of signal to noise, we actually have almost two and a half times improvement in signal to noise using Unispray versus Electrospray for this assay. And again, that's the peak to peak at half height, as you can see. And I've shown you the noise window I've taken, which is again a 1 minute noise window directly after the peak. You can see in terms of the peak shape itself, there isn't really a dramatic difference between the two techniques. It's just the increase in intensity that we see. So in terms of solvent linearity, the method itself is fit for purpose. It's very good. We noticed that the chlorate peak, or I noticed that the chlorate peak was slightly quadratic over the range of 5 to 100 ng/mL. I didn't use any label standards. It's only slightly quadratic. It does fit with a linear fit and meet the SANTI guideline. However, I always like to apply the most appropriate fit to the way the curve is going. So I've applied a quadratic fit. However, I suspect if you use the label standards, you would have a perfectly linear fit as well. However, the quadratic fit fits really well. You can see the R squared value is more than fit for purpose, and the residuals are extremely good. So I then got in to look at vegetables, as I mentioned, having a little bit of a Christmas theme, working with cranberries, but we also looked at Brussels sprouts. So again, I've taken 10 grams of homogenized sprout samples. And again, that's been adjusted for water content. That's called the Quippy method, extracted with the Quippy solvent, vortexed, and then centrifusion filtered. So the blank was actually blank for the chlorate. So we couldn't find any chlorate in the Brussels sprouts until we washed them with drinking water. Again, I will post something on LinkedIn in the coming weeks to discuss that. However, you can see the matrix match standards, again, slightly quadratic curve, but the fit's very good over the range of 5 µg/kg to 200 µg/kg in the Brussels sprouts. Again, not using any labeled standards. You can see all of our back calculated residuals are well within 10% for each of them. And we can see at the 5 µg/kg, we have both transitions present, which of course is important for identification. Comes to the method performance. So here I've done the Quippy extraction with our pre-spikes, and you can see that although the recovery isn't 100%, we actually get a recovery that would meet the requirements of the SANTI guidelines. So the recovery was just under 75%. The RSD is very good at 3.5%, and this is at the 10 µg/kg level, so the LOQ level. So you can see in terms of the SANTI guidelines, the trueness is within the 70 to 120%. RSDs are below 20%, and the ion ratio, as you can see from our graph, were all acceptable based on the average of our standards. In terms of the recovery, I did 1.5 mL of water, as suggested in the Quippy document. However, the commodity itself, I felt was quite dry, so perhaps a little bit more water might be benefiting there. And of course, the use of a label standard would improve the trueness of the method. However, this again does meet the requirements of the SANTI guidelines, and it was fairly consistent as well at this level. Milk, slightly different in the sense that we add a cleanup step in for these compounds. So again, using the Quippy extraction, which allows us to get our protein precipitation because of the use of the 50% methanol from the extraction, but also the 1%, well, becomes 0.5% formic acid, we get quite a significant protein crash that you can observe. Once we centrifuge, we then take 2 mL of the supernatant and we pass it through our Oasis Prime Plus Light cartridge. And this contains 335 mg of Oasis Prime sorbent, which is a reverse phase sorbent that can also retain phospholipids. And again, we then just filter the sample after that. We found that the use of the Oasis Prime device gave us a very clear sample, and it should retain all of the fats and lipids, as well as more hydrophobic components of the matrix as well. So perchlorate, we were able to achieve a curve perfectly within the range that's required again. So the 10 nanograms per mil up to 200 nanograms per mil, or 10 ppb to 200 ppb matrix matched. So no concerns there. Linearity was very good. We could certainly go lower than that as well for perchlorate and still have two transitions present. However, we worked within the range that is required. Sorry, go back. That way, chlorate itself was a little bit more difficult because I couldn't find a milk that had no chlorate in it to be able to show an LOQ level without an estimation of it. So, as I mentioned, this is an example. This is semi-skimmed milk, the one that we use in our laboratory for our cups of tea and coffee. I tested it and I found an incurred residue, and I haven't been able to find a milk yet that doesn't contain an incurred residue of chlorate at some level. So I have tested the Quippy solvent, passing it through Oasis Prime and the PVDF filter. So this is the diluted Quippy solvent, and to make sure that we're not getting any chlorate coming from our devices that we use for cleanup. So it's not present in there. So it's definitely coming from the sample. And you can see the iron ratio matches the mean of the standards, and also the retention time matches where it should be as well. So we're able to use standard addition in our target length XS. We're able to calculate the amount or quantify the amount of chlorate in the milk sample in the absence of an isotopically labeled standard. And you can see we're looking at roughly 49 parts per billion or 49 nanograms per mil in that sample using the standard addition curve. And you can see the curve fits very well again. So I tried to give some estimation of LOQ in milk matrix itself for the system itself, so the sort of estimated system LOQ. So I've done that using fifth-of-the-noise peak-to-peak at half height for the incurred residue, which we have calculated to be 49 nanograms per mil. And based on that, so we take into account that we, for an LOQ, we want to have a peak-to-peak signal-to-noise of 10 to 1. We have an estimated LOQ of 1.3 nanograms per mil using this system. So again, perfectly in line with expectations in terms of LOQs. In terms of the repeatability, it's obviously quite difficult to do because of the incurred residue. So what I did was I took the standard that was spiked, the matrix standard which was spiked at 100 nanograms per mil, and I ran that 15 times, so 15 replicates between our calibration curve and our spiked samples. And again, you can see that we have very low percentage RSD, not surprising at this level, if I'm honest. Again, it does show the robustness of the method and matrix. Again, it's obviously very important because we did have an incurred residue to make sure that we're not seeing any carryover. And actually, you can see quite an extreme example here. So here's our peak for chlorate at 800 nanograms per mil. And directly after that, we've got our filtered solvent blank. And you can see we have no carryover for the method whatsoever. Okay, so that brings me to the end of this update webinar. I hope you found it useful. Just to summarize the last part. So of course we've developed this 5-minute rapid method for chlorate and perchlorate on our Torus DEA 2.1 5 centimeter 1.7 micron column. We're able to achieve more than 2 times the column void volume. We have excellent separation, good retention time stability, well within the 0.1 limit. We have no carryover. We're able to achieve low microgram per kilogram detection and quantification limits. And again, we're able to accurately quantify by standard addition an incurred residue in the milk sample at 49 nanograms per mil. Of course, as I highlighted, the use of label standards is indicated in the Quippy method will, of course, improve method trueness and linearity. Okay, so that brings me to the end of the webinar. It also allows me an opportunity to again highlight that on our waters.com webpage, if you go to www.waters.com/polar pesticides, you can find all of the information on there. We're still updating that page as we have some of our most recent application notes going through our layer procedure. However, they'll be on there very soon, but you can see all of our previous work on there as well. It also allows me to introduce you to our analytical foodies team, which is our European foods team. So again, I'm in the top right for those people who haven't seen me before, but I can also highlight some of my other colleagues. So Benjamin, who has looked after the Q&A box today, is on the left-hand side, second to the left on the top. And I have a number of colleagues such as JD, Jennifer De Alves at the bottom. So second from the bottom left, and then Stuart, who's in the middle to the left, who are two of our application scientists working in Wilmslow, involved in a lot of the new methodologies. And of course, I have my colleagues, Oliver Burks, Karima and Claudia. So Oliver and Karima are at the bottom left, and Karima is next to myself at the top with the red cardigan. And they're our regional market development managers. So they're there to help with your challenges and to discuss your analysis and where our systems and column chemistry and sample prep devices are fit to solve a challenge that you may